I was wrong about Bo Burnham's Inside. When I first watched this film, I didn't really like it that much. Everyone online was raving about how he directed, produced, and edited an entire standard special in just a single room. But I was thinking to myself that it wasn't a big deal. I didn't think so until I saw that Welcome to the Internet was uploaded to YouTube. Not to Netflix's channel, but to Bo's personal channel. At that moment, everything finally clicked with me. The constant references to different things on the internet like YouTube vlogs, reaction videos, Twitch streams, Instagram, and the beauty and horror of having access to infinite amounts of content at every moment. Inside isn't just a stand-up special. It's a YouTube video. Bo produced and edited a feature-length YouTube video and had it distributed through Netflix. When I think of Netflix, I think of big Hollywood productions, not a single person recording themselves in a room. I was thinking like a film student, and not as a user of social media. I was overthinking this movie just because it was on Netflix. After I recovered from that epiphany, I started ruminating on a single question. A question that's been in my mind for the past few months. What other movies would have been better if they were YouTube videos? The film being discussed in this section has themes such as child abuse and bullying. If you'd like to skip this, the timestamp is in the description. Otherwise, let's continue.
This is my school, I guess.
Chronicle is a 2012 found footage film starring Dane DeHaan, Alex Russell, and Michael B. Jordan as Andrew, Matt, and Steve, respectively. The film follows these three high school seniors from Seattle playing pranks and bonding with each other after developing telekinetic powers. You can argue that other found footage films would make good YouTube movies, but Chronicle is a film where Andrew's camera can be seen as a fourth main character. It's treated like a main character by how often the camera's existence is acknowledged throughout the film.
Should I ask about the camera?
New camera's working out for you. It's good.
Hey, is that on?
I'm coming up. I'm bringing the camera, okay?
Is that the camera? You saved me and the camera. Please tell me you got that on tape.
I'm setting the camera down. I'm setting the camera down.
And by how often the characters interact with it.
Is it on?
Yeah. You got it.
How do I work this stupid thing?
The film makes sure to show continuity with the camera's existence and the angles in which it's placed in. In some scenes, the camera is even visible through mirrors, security footage, and other characters filming with their own cameras. Andrew's camera is also what gets him into serious situations. Andrew is bullied and harassed for having it, such as when his school bullies use it to record beating him up, when a partygoer throws their drink at him during misunderstanding, or when his abusive dad finds it after going through his room. Andrew having the camera also causes Matt and Steve to pressure him into going into the hole with them. Andrew was brought along because the other two wanted to film themselves getting a closer look inside the giant tunnel, and Matt was his only ride home.
Matt! Matt, you're my ride home!
The camera being treated like a main character makes the audience feel that the characters are interacting with them and bringing them along for the ride. Andrew finds comfort in being able to film everything that he sees and experiences, like he's using the camera, ergo the viewer, as a confidant. He shares his most vulnerable moments with the audience that he never talks about to others, such as when his father physically and emotionally abuses him. When he's sharing a tender moment with his sick mother.
It's a nice camera.
Oh, thanks, Mom.
When he's crying after being told off by the partygoer. And when he's talking to Steve's grave.
I miss you, Steve.
Andrew doesn't openly admit that he uses the camera for this reason, but instead simply says to Matt,
"It serves a purpose."
Throughout the film, you can also catch moments where he's glancing at the camera while in uncomfortable situations. The camera's further shown to be a comfort object for Andrew whenever he's shown to be protective of it whenever he believes the camera to be in danger. Such as when he's begging his bullies to give it back.
Sean, come on, give it back.
When he's worried about it glitching inside the tunnel.
Is it showing up on the camera like that? I don't know, man. It's messing with it. I don't really want
to
film.
When he flies to save it from falling out of the sky. Or when he floats it out of reach when Matt tries to grab the camera and turn it off. Andrew's desire to film everything is very similar to a daily vlogger on YouTube. Except Andrew uses his camera to show both the good and bad parts of his life. As the film progresses, Andrew becomes even more obsessed with filming everything, such as wanting to get the best shots possible.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah. All right, just make sure and zoom down a little.
Gotcha. I can see you.
Or when Matt yells at him to turn the camera off.
I want to have a conversation
with
you,
okay? Don't tell me what to do, Matt.
You cannot tell me what to do.
Also, like in YouTube videos, you can figure out the characters' personalities by their body language on camera. Before Andrew gets his powers, he shows that he's more reserved by either being behind the camera or with his back to the camera unless he's alone in his room. After getting his powers, he learns to float the camera with his mind and is then able to show more of himself on camera. Matt is shown to be uncomfortable on camera throughout the film because he keeps a barrier between people and doesn't outwardly express himself very often. And Steve is a natural on camera because he's an extrovert who's used to getting attention. The movie relies on you feeling like Andrew, Matt, and Steve are real kids with real lives. The film pulls you in by thinking it's just a regular kid filming things throughout his day, and then you're thrusted into a teen superhero coming-of-age movie. Watching this film on YouTube will sell the illusion that these are people that you might encounter in real life. It's much more realistic that a teenager posted videos of his day on YouTube as opposed to filming a movie to be shown in theaters. Even though the film is almost 10 years old now, it still holds up in terms of its themes of filming oneself as an outlet. It's something that many creators and viewers might have dealt with and might relate to.
There's a trigger warning in place. I'm not going to be offended if you can't watch.
Spree is a 2020 satirical horror film starring Joe Keery as Kirk Kunkel, a wannabe influencer who, during a single day, kills his rideshare passengers and causes chaos in LA in an attempt to go viral. Kirk kills people throughout the film while ignoring advice from successful influencers that he meets throughout the day, and he does whatever the comments say in order to get more viewers. Like Chronicle, this is a found footage film, but instead of using mostly a single camera, Spree uses footage and posts on social media platforms like YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, and Instagram to tell the story through multiple perspectives. The multiple social media clips allow the audience a minute-by-minute third-person omniscient view of the day, seeing what Kurt does and how he affects everyone around him. The core of the film is how Kurt fails to become popular online after over 10 years of producing content. He fails to gain a following because he's not original. He just wants to do whatever is trending, like gaming, vaping, and producing electronic music. He's made himself a blank slate to the point that he no longer acts like a person. He never shares his likes, dislikes, or his personal thoughts about the world.
What I like about these right off the bat is that is how they seem. The mouthfeel on this, otherworldly.
He imitates what is popular without understanding why it's popular. He even fails to understand the point of a Draw My Life video. He glosses over his life story just so he has an excuse to talk about being associated with Bobby Basecamp, a popular influencer who he used to babysit.
Shout out to my friend, Bobby Bud Lee, at Bobby Basecamp.
He treats every social interaction as a chance to plug his social media.
You want
to
tell my followers how you agree your audience? That would be great.
Follow for follow, and if you post anything in my Spree, just make sure to tag me. I'm KurtzWorld96.
Hello, what's going on? KurtzWorld96 here. Follow me for the lesson. Link's in the bio, and I always follow back.
If you could just, like, pop me onto your story, I got a huge audience watching right now.
The only time he doesn't kill anyone in the movie is when he meets someone with a large following, and he believes that he can get a shout-out from them.
Wait, no, you can't take that.
Bobby and Jesse, popular influencers that Kurt meets, try to give him advice throughout the film and explain why they're popular. Bobby is popular because his prank videos are entertaining, even if the viewers know they're fake. As Bobby points out, Jesse is popular because
she's got great energy and an authentic brand.
Kurt consistently ignores their advice and harasses Bobby. After Bobby's finally had enough of him, he finally calls Kurt out on why he'll never be successful.
Just because he used to babysit me when I was like fucking two, he thinks I owe him something. I don't know you shit, dude. You see, guys, the thing about Kurt is he really wants attention, and he needs it too. Fucking medical attention, dude, you're legally insane.
Someone with no sense of humor and no social skills. The face of an inbred dog.
Instead of finally getting the message, Kurt kills Bobby and hijacks Bobby's stream. When Kurt goes to a comedy show Jesse's headlining later that day, Jesse makes a speech about people who act like Kurt.
You're not doing you. You're doing somebody else for somebody else. How are we supposed to know who we are as people if we're just hamming it up all the time?
Even after Kurt sees Jesse's speech about not letting social media take over his life, he kidnaps Jesse so he can force her to make adult content and become popular.
You are freaking me out right now.
For a leaked sex tape? That would be unbelievable.
He wastes every chance he gets to better himself in order to pursue making content. The film is also about how much value people put in online comments. You can watch the film over and over again just so you can read all of them throughout the film. The comments give the audience a glimpse into what bystanders are thinking about throughout the film, and it gives an opportunity for the director to add hidden jokes. The comments point out a few plot holes, like how Kurt survived crashing his car and isn't injured. Why haven't the cops caught Kurt despite Spree having record of Kurt working that day? And why did he get out of the car when he didn't know if Jesse was dead yet?
Can't believe you got out of the car, bro. What a fucking dumbass.
The comments also make observations to what's happening in the story as well, such as noticing that Kurt seems genuinely upset when he sees Jesse talking about him. They mock Kurt and his shortcomings with hashtag Kurt moments. They mock him for saying sorry to Jesse before trying to kill her. And some commenters still thought that everything Kurt did the whole day was staged. Kurt also obeys the comments throughout the movie, doing whatever just for the sake of getting more viewers.
Yeah, dude. You stupid. Okay. Take us to Uno right fucking now. Do something. Run.
When he makes a poll for the live stream chat to decide what to do with Jesse, Kurt fully becomes a bot, doing whatever the chat says, and simply just says,
sorry, Jesse.
Doing whatever for the sake of making the content the comments want. Although some may look at this film as being completely absurd, if you have seen or experienced people doing things for clout, you may find the premise of the film to be completely believable. A recap of the movie on YouTube has over 11 million views at the time of me recording, because people thought it was actually a real story. A lot of people have done stupid things in order to go viral and get attention. The film would be great for YouTube for its satire of social media and how people act in order to gain followers and attention. Although it's satire, there's still some truth to how much people want to be famous online and will do almost anything for it.
Oi, Henry, I'm at this high-class establishment. Follow the dot and then just knock on the knocker. Get it? Knock on the knocker!
Hardcore Henry is the 2015 directorial debut of Ilya Naishuller, who will go on to direct the film Nobody. The film's about a man named Henry who, with the help of his friend Jimmy, is trying to find Henry's wife in Moscow. She was kidnapped by Akan, a man who stole her research so he could build a cyborg army. Hardcore Henry is an action movie filmed entirely through a first-person perspective, and the titular character's face is only shown to the audience near the end. The first-person view allows the audience to see the entire story through Henry's perspective and experience everything he does. When he's struggling, when he's climbing a building, or when he's trying to defend himself. There are many parts in the movie when you see and hear Henry anxious or in pain. The audience is exactly on the same page as Henry in the film. The audience doesn't know anything about Henry since he has amnesia and doesn't know anything about himself. Henry is unable to talk, leaving him with only his body language to communicate.
Are you married? How's that working out for you? Yeah, I'm kidding.
He's in a place he's not familiar with, so Jimmy gives him a phone to tell him where to go. This movie doesn't work in theaters because of this. The movie is clearly a video game. The movie is entirely in first person. Henry isn't able to talk. He has to defeat a bunch of enemies before he can get to Akan. And Jimmy tells him what to do and where to go. The movie is a first-person shooter, with Henry as a silent protagonist, Jimmy as the tutorial character, and Akan is the final boss. The movie makes several references to video games throughout the whole movie. Jimmy calls Henry on the phone to tell him his objectives.
Henry, stop dicking around. You're almost there, mate. Here's where you gotta get to. Chop chop.
Characters tell Henry how to fight.
They underestimate you, okay? Let them get close and then engage.
Every action scene feels like you're playing a fight scene in a game. The scenes of Henry doing parkour is like you're playing Mirror's Edge. Henry getting adrenaline in the middle of the battle is him getting a power-up. A Payday 2 poster can be seen in a room Henry climbs into, and Henry does a rocket jump in the forest. The scene with Henry transporting the real Jimmy out of the lab is just a level where you have to fend off the enemies long enough in order to progress the game. Jimmy's clones give Henry his objective, and give a tutorial during that whole scene.
Right, Private, it is our duty to ensure that no harm comes to the cripple. Understood?
If you can hear them, but you can't shoot them, you can probably grenade them. Drop an egg down there, laddie.
Don't let the cripple get below you, laddie!
Jimmy created clones of himself so that he's able to do things since he's paralyzed. He's like a gamer living through his video game characters. He even calls them his avatars.
Really, just fancy pants prosthesis, but don't dare tell.
My avatars!
I also think that his avatars looking similar with different personalities is likely a reference to when games reuse the same character models for different characters. The movie also makes fun of the fake backstory that Henry was given by showing that other cyborgs were given the same story.
I love you, Charlie. I love you, Edward. I love you, Thomas.
Akan did this in order to test if Henry would obey anything Estelle told him to. This is hinted at multiple times in the movie when Akan says he'll tell Estelle how well he's doing.
Your persistence is unparalleled. And quite exciting.
I'll tell Estelle you did well.
Estelle! Your boy's quite the white knight, sacrificing himself to keep you alive.
When Jimmy sees that Henry has a memory blocker, even though he was told he lost his memories due to an accident.
Look at this. Dude's got a memory blocker.
And when Jimmy refers to Henry as Akan's toy robot, after seeing that Akan was tracking Henry the whole time.
What the fuck was I thinking? That Akan's toy robot was my friend!
Akan is basically a game developer mocking the player for playing the game a certain way.
Every single one of my soldiers will awake willing to do anything my brilliant wife tells him. Whether it's marching on Paris or the White House lawn.
But Henry fights back and defeats Akan and Estelle after getting memories of his real life. The movie being a video game allows it to be able to have fun with itself and make the movie more enjoyable. The movie being on YouTube would be a bit of a no-brainer. The movie itself was inspired by music videos also directed by Nate Schuller that went viral. The music videos were for his rock band Biting Elbows, which were also filmed in first person. There was already an established audience of people who were engaging with the music videos, so it'd make the most sense to post the movie to YouTube. It's also a video game movie. Gaming is one of the most popular genres on YouTube, and game parodies are very popular on the platform. Real-life video game parodies do well on YouTube because video games are universal. Everyone has played or watched a video game before, and parodies make fun of how silly some games can be. A movie that satirizes first-person shooter games would go viral just like any other gaming-related content on YouTube. It's a movie that doesn't take itself seriously, and it's a fun watch for people who enjoy video games. These are just a few movies I could think of that would do well on YouTube. Bo Burnham's Inside showed me that some films are just meant for YouTube. YouTube definitely isn't perfect by any means, but it still has a lot to offer. There are thousands of channels that produce amazing content, like Defunctland, who makes documentaries about old amusement parks and TV shows. I get most of my news from Internet Today, Blame It on Jorge talks about lost media. Krambrischer's currently working on a stop-motion animation series. Cinematic Extrament is reviewing every movie that's won the Worst Picture Razzie. I found so many good indie films through Amanda the Jedi. CinemaWins redeems hated movies. Scott the Waz's game retrospectives are hilarious. Even John Oliver posts exclusive segments to YouTube and not HBO Max. These creators and countless others are producing content that can be seen by the entire world for free, with no region locks. YouTube has tools that allow the viewers to connect to the content and the creator more effectively than Netflix or Hulu. Viewers can timestamp moments they liked, moments that made them laugh, made them cry, or surprised them, like or dislike comments they agreed or disagreed with. The creators can reply directly and talk to everyone. Viewers can subscribe so that they can see more from the creator whenever they make a new video, and show the creator that the viewers want more of what they're doing. But most importantly, viewers can share the videos with other people to watch it and experience it as well. The content on Netflix like Tiger King and Squid Game went viral because of people talking about it on other sites, like YouTube, Twitter, and TikTok. Then they went to Netflix to watch it for themselves. The only thing you can do on Netflix is watch something and give it a thumbs up. YouTube is great in that we don't have to wonder if something like this is possible. Daniel Gildark posted his indie film Cthulhu, along with director's commentary, onto YouTube after his film failed to gain traction. Gildark posted them in order to serve as a teaching tool for other fellow directors, and to help them not make the same mistakes that he did. Now it's being seen by people who would have never been able to see it otherwise. I'm glad that he took the chance and put his work out there, and others should take that chance too. YouTube has a page full of movies that are free to watch right now. At the time of me recording this, the theatrical version of Chronicle is completely free to watch. No rental or purchase required. There's also films like the original Godzilla, Airplane, Paranormal Activity, and 10 Cloverfield Lane. I left a link in the description if you want to check out what else is available. These movies being free to watch on YouTube have opened the gates to the possibilities of how we can experience movies. Films like Chronicle, Spree, and Hardcore Henry are films that just don't work when seen in theaters. Their themes and messages are much harder to convey if told through a big projector in a theater. In the films, the characters are almost always close up to the camera, looking directly at it, making the viewer feel a sense of closeness. The viewer can pick up on subtleties like their body language and facial expressions, or in Kurt's case, how forced and unauthentic it is. The scenes become more claustrophobic and more intense, like you're experiencing the story along with them, like Matt desperately trying to stop Andrew from destroying the city, Jesse trying to escape from Kurt, and Henry finding the courage to fight back against Akan. All of these moments wouldn't be as effective if it was on typical streaming service. So we should support directors who post their movies to YouTube, because without YouTube, films might not be able to reach a wider audience or reach their full storytelling potential, and a lot of filmmakers might never be discovered.